Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
Like to tell you a story today. If you attend here often, you know that it is not my custom to tell stories during the 11 o'clock service or worship service. But this is a story that I believe is appropriate to tell because it is a story having to do with our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a story having to do with his life here on earth and the major part of his ministry. And it is very difficult to find a good map of the Sea of Galilee. That's the common name for Christians of this little body of water. You can see it's also called several other names. It's called the Sea of Chinnereth. Well, Lake Gennesaret, Sea of Tiberias, was named later. It is a relatively small body of water in northern Palestine, not in Judah, but in the area that was populated by the 10 tribes. And the reason that this body of water is so interesting to study for Christians is that it was in this surrounding region, right around this lake or small sea, that Jesus spent most of his ministry, and almost everything that you read in the Synoptic Gospels occurred in this region. If you have your Bible, I'll just show you. If you look in the Gospel of Matthew, by the time you get to chapter 4 and verse 23, you're in this area. And most of the rest of everything you read in the Gospel of Matthew until the very end of Jesus' life took place in this area. If you go to the Gospel of Mark, in Mark, the first chapter, by the time you get to Mark 1, verse 21, you're up here in this area. And almost everything you read later in the Gospel of Mark took place up here, except a few trips that Jesus took to Jerusalem. If you go to the Gospel of Luke, in the Gospel of Luke, by the time you get to Luke 4:31, you're up in this area. And almost everything you read in the Gospel of Luke took place in that area, except the final scenes. So, when you read the Synoptic Gospels, most of what you're reading took place up here in northern Palestine around the Sea of Galilee. Now, here's a few points of interest around this sea. On this map, do you see right here? Right there? Right underneath there, it says City of Capernaum. Now, I personally believe that that's a mistake. There is no modern city where the city of Capernaum was, and nobody knows for sure exactly where the city of Capernaum was, and that is one of the two possible locations. The reason that I don't believe that that's the city of Capernaum, was the ancient city of Capernaum, is because the archaeological excavations that have been done in that city, ancient city, the ruins of that ancient city, indicate that it was an Arab city. And where I am almost sure that the Capernaum actually existed was over here, right there. There was another ancient city right there, and excavations in that city show that it contained a large Jewish synagogue, and Capernaum did have a large Jewish synagogue. In fact, Jesus spoke in that synagogue, and what he said was recorded in John, the sixth chapter. And you can see it's a little bit on the north and also on the west side of the lake. And Capernaum is a very significant city that's in the Gospels mentioned over and over and over again. And it is mentioned over and over again in the Spirit of Prophecy. The book Desire of Ages has a whole chapter about it. And this city, of course, as you can see just by looking, it was what we would call today a seaport city. Now, this Sea of Galilee, or Lake Gennesaret, as you would prefer to call it, this sea is not at sea level. This sea is almost 700 feet below the level of the Mediterranean Sea. So it's in a deep depression. Now, some of you here, you have climbed mountains, or you have gone to the Grand Canyon, and you have maybe walked down the Grand Canyon. In the daytime, in the summer, when you walk down the Grand Canyon, does it get cooler or hotter? It gets hotter. And when you walk up a mountain, does it get cooler or hotter? it gets cooler. So when you go up, when your elevation increases, it gets cooler. When you go down, the temperature increases. So this would be a extremely hot desert area if it wasn't for this body of water. But as you all know, the water, a large body of water, exerts an effect, a moderating effect on the extremes of temperature. So because it was very low and yet you had this large body of water, this place had a wonderful climate. It wasn't a place that got to 120 degrees like at the bottom of the Grand Canyon, but it was a place with a gentle, warm, nice climate most of the year, which was an advantage to Jesus because a large part of his ministry was outdoors. And it was in this area in Jesus' time, there were a lot of palm trees, olive groves, all kinds of vineyards and orchards all around. It was a very productive area. If you look on the map, maybe you can read it, some of you, right along here, right here, right along there. That's called the Plain of Gennesaret. Now, that is right above the city, there's where the city of Capernaum was, right below that red dot. And right above that's this plain of Gennesaret. And that was a very, very fertile region. Off over to the other side, over here, you see right there below that, that's the city of Bethsaida. Now, this can be a little confusing when you read your Bible if you don't start comparing, because the Bible says in the first chapter of John that the city of Bethsaida was the city of Andrew, Peter, and Peter. In other words, it was their hometown. It was where the apostle Peter grew up. But even though that's where he grew up, that is not where Peter was living during the time of Jesus' ministry, because both the Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Luke make it very, very clear that Peter's home was not here. Peter's home was over here, the city of Capernaum. Both the Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Luke make that very, very clear. We call it the city of Capernaum. Actually, the historians tell us that that wasn't the original name. They tell us that the original name for this city was Capharnaum, and that it was derived from two Semitic words, kafar, which means a village, and Nahum, or Nahum. And some have even speculated that this city was the hometown of Nahum the prophet, but I cannot find any historical evidence to vindicate that speculation. Other people have looked at the Hebrew word Nahum and said, well, no, this means it's the village of consolation. This city of Capernaum also was significant because there were high, now you can't see it on this map, but there were major roads from this city to Sidon and also from this city to Damascus on the north and Syria and Jerusalem on the south. So a person or a tradesman or a trading caravan that was going from Damascus down to Jerusalem or to Egypt would go through Capernaum. So it was a travel center. It was a place where travelers, trading caravans, often went. And of course, that is an advantage to any city, because when travelers pass through a city, what do they do? Well, they need lodging, and they need food, and they might need some other supplies, and so that generates wealth for any city. And that's the way many cities have become large cities. In the latter part of the 18th century and the early part, or the 17th century and the 18th century, this town of Chicago became a route. It became a travel center, so that when my grandparents, who lived in southern Illinois, when they were going to travel somewhere, or when Ellen White was going to travel somewhere from Battle Creek, you first went to Chicago. And then when you got to Chicago, then you could get a train from there going to any part of the country. But you first went to Chicago. That was a travel center. That is also the way later on that Denver, Colorado became a large city. It became a travel hub. When you were going west, you went to there, and then you went to there to different places in the west. That's also in the 20th century. One of the things that made Honolulu a big city is that it was a travel center. In fact, clear up until the 1980s, people that were traveling by airplane, going either to the Orient or coming from the Orient to the Americas, would stop in Honolulu. That's not so much today, because in the last few years we now have airplanes that can fly almost 9,000 miles nonstop, and so we don't stop in Honolulu so much. We just go directly to wherever we're going today. But until the 1980s, Honolulu was a famous spot for travelers passing either direction. And so Capernaum was a city like that, and that made it a thriving business center. And because it was a travel stop, it was a city that had many nationalities in it, although there was a large Jewish population there. Now, before we start looking at what happened in Capernaum, we need to look at the setting of how Jesus even came to be in Capernaum. I have pondered this many times in my life. Jesus would never have had to come to Capernaum. That was not his first choice of where to come. Have you ever been in a situation where your first choice didn't work out, so now you go to plan B or plan C? Have you ever had that happen to you? That happened to Jesus. Capernaum actually was not his first choice of where to locate his ministry, although it became the place where it was known as his own city, because it became the headquarters of Jesus' ministry all around that region. But to understand how that happened, we need to take a look in the Bible and see how that happened, that it even got to Capernaum in the first place to get the setting of the story. And before we read these things in the Bible, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, we come to you very humbly, but earnestly, recognizing that without your Holy Spirit, we will not understand spiritual things. Lord, we know that it is our own spiritual experience that often limits what we can understand that you are trying to teach us. So we humbly but earnestly pray that to the limit of our understanding, that your Holy Spirit will lead us to understand the truth that you're trying to teach us. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Some of you have studied, and if you were at our revival meetings that we had here several weeks ago with Pastor Stephen Lutis, we studied one night about the 2300 days prophecy in Daniel 8 and 9. And from the 2300 day prophecy, and from comparing that with the third chapter of the Gospel of Luke, and then looking at the history book to find out when the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar was, we can establish exactly when Jesus came and was baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist, and when his ministry began. When Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist in the Jordan River, that was in the fall of what, in our terminology, in our dating system, is the fall of 27 AD. And after his baptism, the first year and a third or so, year and a half of his ministry was what we call a Judean ministry. His ministry was especially for the land of Judea. He spent most of his time in Judea. However, during this period of time, he took a couple of trips up into the region of Galilee. The Bible records these trips that he took. And, of course, the Lord knew what was going to happen. But even though he knew what was going to happen, he gave people opportunity to make a decision. Now, we're going to study something right now that bothers a lot of people, so you may want to shut ears for a moment if this is troubling to you. I'm not trying to disturb you, but there are some people that are very, very disturbed by the idea that God knows the future. And some people say, well, if God knows whether I'm going to be saved or not, why should I even try? Well, your salvation, even though God knows it, your salvation is dependent upon your choice. And God is going to give you every opportunity to make the right decision, whether you make the right decision or not. God's going to give you every opportunity he can give you to make the right decision so you can be saved. And God did that for the Jewish people. Every effort was made to bring salvation to the land of Israel, to the Sanhedrin, to the Jews, because Judea was actually the world headquarters of Judaism, or the Israelite religion, the people of God. That was the worldwide headquarters, and if they would have accepted it rapidly, the knowledge of Jesus Christ as the Messiah would have gone to all parts of the world, because there were Jews scattered to all parts of the world in those days. They were called the diaspora, the Jews that were dispersed. And so we would know almost nothing about this period of Jesus' ministry except for the Gospel of John. And the Gospel of John gives us an idea of what was going on. And in the Gospel of John, you will find Jesus' Judean ministry from chapters 1 to the end of chapter 5. Those five chapters in the Gospel of John cover the period in Jesus' ministry between the fall of 27 A.D. and the Passover in 29 A.D., which was approximately a year and a half later. In the Passover, what happened at the Passover in 28 A.D. is recorded in the latter part of John 2. That's when Jesus cleansed the temple. Ellen White says that that is the way that he announced his messiahship. Just a few months after his baptism, he announced his messiahship by cleansing the temple. And anybody that had a candid mind could not fail to see that there was something more than human going on when that happened. During this period of time, since he was going to offer salvation first to the leaders among the Jews, which he did, is during this period of time that one of the leaders of the Sanhedrin came to Jesus by night. The story is recorded in John, the third chapter. His name was Nicodemus, you remember. And he wanted to find out. Jesus explained to him, this was a leader of the Sanhedrin, he explained to him the gospel in a clearer way than you will find it anywhere else in all the gospels. That's in John, the third chapter. Read it in your Bible, verses 1 to 21. John 3. That was during this first period between the fall of 27 AD after Jesus' baptism and the end of Jesus' Judean ministry, which is at the Passover. Jesus' Judean ministry ended at the Passover in 29 A.D. 28 A.D., you record in John, the second chapter, he cleansed the temple. And in the Passover in 29 A.D., look in John, the fifth chapter, says in John 5:1, it says, after this there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now we know for sure, I won't go through the proof to explain to you how right now, but we know for sure that that feast of the Jews was the feast of the Passover in 29 A.D. And John 5 records what happened at the feast of the Passover with Jesus in 29 A.D. Before that time, he had made at least two missionary trips up to the region of Galilee, up here. And on one of those trips, it's recorded in John, the fourth chapter, a nobleman from Capernaum, that's this town right here, that's where it really is, not up there where you see it on the map, a nobleman from that town had come to Jesus whose son was at the point of death. The story is all recorded in the latter part of John 4. And you remember, that's the time when Jesus said to this father, because when the man came to Jesus, he just saw somebody that was travel-worn and looked like a common, ordinary person, and he was about to say, well, is this really who I thought it was? And Jesus knew exactly what he was thinking, and he said to him, unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. And that hit that father like a bolt of lightning, because he understood that who was talking to him knew what was going on in his mind. Jesus did that often. One of the constant signs of his divinity was that he told you what you were thinking before you said anything. That happened over and over again. You find many, many instances of that recorded in the Gospels. And Matthew even says, Jesus saw their thoughts. And he said, why are you thinking this? And they couldn't deny it because he told them what they were thinking. And Jesus said to this father, he said, unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. It was just like a shot of electricity went through that man. He realized he was talking to somebody that knew what he was thinking and what he was feeling before he said or did anything. He knew he was in the presence of somebody that wasn't just human. And he said, Lord, he knew that unless the Lord granted his request, his son would die. He said, Lord, my son's going to die. Jesus said, you can go home. Your son's living. And he knew that when Jesus spoke that his son would live, and he turned around and walked away. He didn't even get in a hurry to go home. He got lodging that night, so he didn't have to walk all the way home, and he didn't arrive home until the next morning. When he was close to home, his servants saw him coming, and they rushed out to tell him. They said, tell him the good news, your son's alive, and he wasn't surprised at all. And he said, well, when did he begin to get better? He said, yesterday about 1 p.m. And the father knew it was the exact time that Jesus said to him, your son lives. And so it says that he believed and all of his house. We don't know how big a house he was, but this man lived in Capernaum. And what had happened with this man's servant, it was noised all about the town. So the whole town of Capernaum knew about Jesus because this man was a believer and he spread it all over town about Jesus. That happened during Jesus' Judean ministry when he was on one of these missionary trips up to Galilee. That was all, of course, a pre-planned event to prepare the way for Jesus to make that the headquarters of his ministry. But before that happened, Jesus gave the Jewish leaders every opportunity to accept him as the Messiah, even though he knew they wouldn't. He gave them every opportunity. My dear friend, let me talk to you really, really bluntly, really plainly. If you are lost, if you do not gain eternal life, you will face the fact in the judgment that God gave you every possible opportunity to be saved, but you didn't take the opportunity. The Bible says that God does not want anyone, Peter said this, God does not want anybody to be lost. He wants everybody to come to a knowledge of the truth. But God doesn't force anybody. And he gave these Jewish leaders every opportunity. And sometimes when I was a child and I was reading my Bible, I was just like the disciples. I would say in my mind, well, Lord, why did you do that? You got yourself in so much trouble. It was intentional that he got himself in trouble. Because when Jesus went up to Jerusalem in 29 AD at the time of the Passover, it says in John 5 that there was a man there by the pool of Bethesda who had had his sickness for 38 years. He was lying on a little cot, what we would call like a blanket, a mat. He's lying there by the pool of Bethesda. You can read the story in the first part of John 5. And Jesus came up this man. I mustn't cry because sometimes I get tears in my eyes when I read this story. He said to this man, "Do you want to be made whole? What would you say if you had been lying on a cot, if you'd been sick for 38 years and somebody come up and asked you if you wanted to be well? What would you say?" This man said, "Lord, yes, I'd like to, but I don't have anybody to help me into the pool. And therefore, I never make it in time." By the way, you can study this out on your own, but it was not an angel of God that troubled the pool. That was one of the devil's angels that troubled that pool. That was all the work of the devil going on there. But you can study that on your own. God doesn't work the way that thing was operated. Never, ever. He said, "I don't have anybody to help me into the pool." And Jesus said, "Get up. Take your bed and walk." The man stood up, rolled up his bed, put it on his shoulder. This is in Jerusalem, friends. This is not up here in Galilee. This is in Jerusalem. Jesus gone down. This is the end of Jesus' Judean ministry. And he walks out, and the Bible says, that day was the Sabbath. Now, this is one of the places in Jesus' life when I read the story, I used to say to myself, "Lord, why did you get yourself in so much trouble?" You see, if Jesus had just told him to go and walk out in the street, he'd have been all right. But Jesus said, "Take up your bed. Carry it." And these people had been educated in what they believed was proper Sabbath observance. They didn't believe in healing the sick on the Sabbath day. In fact, we won't take time to read it, but you can read it happened actually in Capernaum. It didn't happen here, but it happened in Capernaum just a short time after this, that Jesus was in a synagogue, the synagogue in Capernaum, and he healed somebody in a synagogue on the Sabbath day, and the ruler of the synagogue got angry because he healed on the Sabbath day, and he said, "Why don't you come some other day and be healed, not on the Sabbath?" The Bible says that Jesus looked on them with anger. Some people believe that God doesn't get angry. But the Bible says Jesus looked on them with anger. Jesus didn't tell this man just to get up and walk. He said, "Take up your bed and go." I've thought of this story so often. Now, my friends, I believe in the law of God. I believe in the Ten Commandments, including the Fourth Commandment, the Sabbath Commandment. If we were preaching on a different subject, I could show you from the New Testament that the New Testament commands us to keep the Sabbath many decades after the cross. That's not the issue. Sabbath or Sunday or Friday, or the day is not the issue. The issue here is how do you keep the day? How do you keep the Sabbath? That's not our subject, so we have to stop and study that some other time. But Jesus told this man, "Pick up your bed and go. Don't just walk away. Pick up your bed. Carry it. This is the Sabbath, and go." That's something for you to study out. How to keep the Sabbath. Was it wrong for this man to carry his bed on the Sabbath? Evidently not, because if it was, Jesus wouldn't have told him to pick up his bed and walk. Jesus could have told him, "Just walk out in the street and leave your bed here. Come get it tomorrow." And he wouldn't have gotten in trouble at all. He could have just walked out in the street and just mingled with everybody else. But when the Jews saw him and They said, "Don't you know it's the Sabbath?" The man was so excited, he had just about forgotten that it was the Sabbath. Can't you understand how that could be? If you've been laying down and sick for 38 years and now all of a sudden you are perfectly well and you could walk, wouldn't you be excited? He was so excited, he didn't even think it was the Sabbath. It's the Sabbath, don't you know? Well, who did this? I don't know. Man came and told me to get up and walk, and I got him walked. I don't know who it was. But Jesus wanted them to find out who it was. So the man, since when he found out it was the Sabbath, he went down to the temple. He was a Jew. He went down to the temple. But Jesus went down to the temple too and found him. And Jesus told him who he was. And he told him, he said, "Now, don't sin anymore, because if you sin more, something worse could happen to you than what happened to you last time." And so the man did, of course, he didn't know that the Jews hated Jesus. And so he told him, he said, he thought it was wonderful news. He said, "A man called Jesus, he's the one that made me well." And the Bible says, Jesus was taken now to court. This is the Sabbath. He's taken to the Sanhedrin, to the highest court of the Jewish nation. He's going to be tried for Sabbath breaking. Now, it wasn't just Sabbath breaking. If you go through the rest of John 5, you will find that there were several charges and countercharges that were made at this trial. First of all, Jesus was charged with being a Sabbath breaker. By the way, just an interesting aside, I have a number of books in my library written by very learned clergymen who have doctor's degrees, who think the same as the Jews. I could show you a number of books in my library written by clergymen who have doctor's degrees in theology who believe the same as the Jews. Let me see if you've ever heard this, because this is a common charge made even in Protestant churches today, that Jesus was a Sabbath breaker. I want to find out if anybody's ever... I want to see hands. If anybody has ever heard anybody say that they think that Jesus was a Sabbath... Am I the only one that's heard that? There's a few people here that have heard that. That's a fairly common charge that is made even in Protestant churches, that Jesus was a Sabbath breaker. But I want you to notice what Jesus said himself about whether or not he was a Sabbath breaker. Look in your Bible in John the 15th chapter. Verse 10, John 15:10. Jesus said, "If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." Well, what was the problem? Jesus said he did not break the Sabbath. He was a Sabbath keeper. He said, "I have kept my Father's commandments." The Jews said, "No, you're a Sabbath breaker." What was the problem? The problem, my dear friends, is the same problem that human beings often have today. They got confused between man's rules and God's rules. I said it a different way. They became confused between man's commandments and God's commandments. Now let's be real specific so we know exactly what we're talking about. We have laws in our country made by the city of Wichita, we have laws made by Sedgwick County, and we have laws made by the state of Kansas, and we have laws made by the federal government in Washington, D.C. We have all those four levels of laws in our country. Now, those are all man's laws, and we should keep man's laws as long as they don't violate God's laws. Well, how many laws do we need? Now, I don't have any idea, but other people have tried to estimate how many laws have we made. One person estimated that the human race has made in the neighborhood of 35 billion laws. And I heard that, and I thought, that's the most unbelievable thing. Well, you can study that out for yourself. If we've made, whether it's 35 billion or 3 billion, doesn't really make any difference to me. An innumerable number of laws that we made, and human laws are right and good. Without law, we would have chaos. We cannot have any organized society without law. So we're not against law. But let me ask you this question. If it is impossible to have a city or a county or a state or a union of the United States, or any other country for that matter, if it is impossible to have any organized society in any country in the world without having some laws, and it's not, every country has laws. So if we have to have laws to have a city, a county, a state, or the United States, do you think that it's possible that God can run the whole universe without any laws, like some people think? Do you think that's possible? But the difference is, God doesn't need 35 billion. He said, I'm going to give you a law, one law, it'll have 10 parts, and God governs the whole universe with just that one law, with 10 parts. And Jesus said, I've kept it. They said, you've broken it. The reason they said that you've broken it is because they were confused between God's law and man's law. You see, this is what they had done after the captivity. Before the captivity, if you read the Old Testament, the Jews fell into idolatry over and over and over again. Have you read that in the Old Testament? Now, why they did that is not our subject, so we won't go into that, how that happened, why that happened. There's some very good reasons. But after the captivity, they did learn one lesson when they're in the Babylonian captivity. They knew that they were there because of their idolatry, and they said, when they came back to the promised land, they said, we're never going to fall into idolatry again. Well, how are you going to keep from falling into idolatry? They figured out a way. By the way, they didn't. Jesus did not accuse the Pharisees of being idolaters. They did not worship idols. That was anathema to them. That's one of the reasons they hated the Samaritans, because the Samaritans were still involved in some idolatry. The Jews were not. How did they avoid it? They said, we are never going to fall into idolatry again. We're never going to break God's law again, because what we're going to do, we are going to erect a fence around God's law, so that you'll never break it. Before you break it, you'll come to the fence. And this fence that they erected around God's law, they made a lot of traditions. The written ones were called the Talmud, the oral ones called the Mishnah, and they had all these traditions. And that would, if you follow all these traditions, that would keep you from breaking God's law. So they made regulations. Let's take the Sabbath commandment. On the Sabbath, do you think it would be right to this morning if instead of coming to church, you just got in your car and say, well, I think we'll start on a trip to California? Would that be the right way to keep the Sabbath, just be traveling all the time? Well, no, that wouldn't be the right way to keep the Sabbath. Well, they understood things like that. You shouldn't be going from Jerusalem up to Capernaum on the Sabbath. That'd take you 3 days. And so they said, we're going to make a rule. And it's mentioned in the New Testament. They said on the Sabbath day, you can go this far in your journey. That was called a Sabbath day's journey. You can travel this far on the Sabbath. Then you're not to travel any more than that. That way you won't break the Sabbath. You won't be traveling all the Sabbath. They made all kinds of rules. The Old Testament taught the people not to prepare the food, do their cooking on the Sabbath. And so they made rules about fires and lights, and you couldn't spit. Because if you spit, it might water a plant. That would be irrigating on the Sabbath. They had so many rules and regulations to guard Sabbath observance that the Sabbath eventually became a burden, and God never intended for all of those rules to be kept. And that's why Jesus got in trouble over and over again. You can read about it in the Gospel. Over and over again, Jesus got in trouble. They said he was breaking the Sabbath, and Jesus said, no, I'm not. Jesus kept the Sabbath according to the Old Testament, but not according to all these rules. But now he's on trial for his life because they're calling him a Sabbath breaker. But some other issues came to play in this trial. Look in your Bible in John, the 5th chapter. You will find, point one was he was accused of being a Sabbath breaker. Point two, he claimed that he was a divine personage equal to the Father. That was point number two. He declared that he was a divine personage equal to the Father. And they understood that claim. And they got so angry with that claim, they decided they're going to kill him. And a third claim that he made on that occasion, he said, I am going to judge everybody. In other words, you think you're going to judge me, but no, that's not the way it is. The time's coming when, he said, the Father doesn't judge anybody. He's committed all judgment to the Son. I'm going to judge everybody, you. You think you're judging me, but I'm going to judge you. They didn't like that either. And then Jesus made another claim that they decided was absolutely preposterous. At this time, now later, Jesus raised people from the dead, but at this time, that hadn't happened yet. But Jesus predicted that he was going to do it. He said, just as the Father raises the dead, also the Son, whoever he wants to, he makes alive. And if that didn't take your breath away, he said, listen, if you believe in me, you're not going to come into judgment. You have eternal. If you believe in me, you have eternal life. You have passed from death unto life. Read it in John 5:24. Not only that, he said, I'm going to raise the dead. The dead are going to hear my voice. Not only that, then he made one of the most sweeping statements you'll find in all of the gospel in John 5:28-29. He says, don't marvel at what I told you now. He said, the hour is coming when all the dead, everybody that's in a grave, is going to hear my voice. And they're going to come out of the grave. Those that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and those that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation or condemnation. They still didn't believe. This is a final appeal. After, when they reject this appeal, Jesus is going to leave town. He's going to go up here to Capernaum. He's going to spend most of the rest of his ministry in this region around the Sea of Galilee. But before he does that, he's going to give these people every opportunity to accept him as the Messiah and be saved. Give them every opportunity to have everlasting life. Just like he is giving you every opportunity to have everlasting life, but it's your choice. It was their choice for them. It's your choice for you. And so now he's going to make an appeal. Now there are some revivalists, there are some evangelists, and I'm not trying to condemn anybody for doing this, but there are some people that appeal to people's emotions. We all have emotions, and emotions are right and proper in their place. But it is dangerous to make a major decision in your life based just on emotion without your intellect. Your intellect should always be in control of your emotions. So now Jesus is going to make to them appeal, and he's going to give them the evidence. And he's going to tell them, why should you believe that what I'm telling you is the truth? I've just told you that I'm a divine personage and I'm equal with the Father. All judgment has been committed to me. I'm going to raise the dead. In fact, the time is going to come when every single person that's in a grave is going to hear my voice. And they're going to come out. Some will have eternal life, some will have condemnation, depending on what they've done. Now, these are very sweeping claims. Why should you believe that what I'm telling you is the truth? I'm going to tell you now why you should believe what I'm telling you is the truth. I'm going to give you four lines of evidence as to why you should believe what I'm telling you, that it's the truth. The first line of evidence is John the Baptist says that I'm the Messiah. You went out to hear John the Baptist, and for a while you were willing to believe what he said. For an hour you were willing to rejoice in the light that he gave you. Actually, I don't receive testimony from men, but I'm just telling you this so that you can be saved, so you can make the right decision. But I have greater evidence. I have greater evidence. There's greater evidence than John the Baptist that shows that what I'm telling you is the truth. The works that I do bear witness of me that what I'm telling you is the truth. They just saw this man been sick 38 years. Have you noticed that when somebody's been sick 38 years, a physician doesn't cure them like that? Have you ever noticed that? I'm not criticizing physicians, but human physicians do not cure a man that's been sick for 38 years in an instant. But Jesus did. And that's not the only miracle. He had worked many miracles in Jerusalem and Judea. And they knew about these miracles. And Jesus said, these works that I've done bear witness that what I'm telling you is the truth. But that's not all. There's a third line of evidence of what I'm telling you. If you look in your Bible in John 5:37. Jesus says, that's not the only evidence. The Father himself has borne witness of me. When did that happen? You remember at Jesus' baptism, it's recorded in Matthew 3:16-17. When Jesus was baptized, the Holy Spirit came down in the form of a dove upon him. But not only that, there was a voice from heaven that said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Listen to him. Jesus said, it's not just John the Baptist, it's not just the works that I do. The Father himself has borne testimony that I'm who I say I am. But even that's not all. There's a fourth witness. And you have the witness right with you. You have what we call today the Old Testament Scriptures. And you search these Scriptures because you think that by searching those Scriptures, you're going to have eternal life. But the fact is, those Scriptures all testify about me. If you understand the Bible that you have, you'll understand it's all about me. There's four lines of evidence. What I'm telling you is the truth, that I'm who I say I am. John the Baptist, the works that I do, the Father in heaven has borne witness, and the Scriptures, all four. Did that convince them? Look at verse 40. That did not convince them. Jesus said to them, "You won't come to me so that you can have life." Then verse 41, he says, "I do not receive honor from men, but I know you," verse 42, "but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in yourselves." I've come here to speak to you in my Father's name, and you will not listen. But if somebody else comes in his own name, you'll listen to him. Why were they so prejudiced? Prejudice is a very difficult thing to understand, even though I suppose we all have prejudices. But human beings are social creatures, and human beings all associate in organized groups for a group activity. Now, this group can be a club or a school, or a business, or a ministry, or an institution, or a church, or an army. All those are groups, human groups. Every group has rules, or traditions, or policy. And if you disregard the rules or traditions or policies of that group, you will receive the discipline of that group. Now, what discipline you will receive depends on what the group is. If the group is a club, you won't be allowed to be a member. If the group is the military, you could be shot. That's one of the ways that Abraham Lincoln got into so much trouble with the army during the Civil War, because he sometimes forgave people that had violated a military order and were in prison or were sentenced to be shot, and he decided to exercise mercy upon them and forgave them, and he got into lots of trouble with his generals. In a church, and the Jews were like a church, in a church, if you disregard the rules or the traditions, there's generally three steps. They took all these three steps with Jesus. Number one, they will give you a warning. Stop. Whatever you're doing, stop. Now, if you don't listen to the warning, then you will be excommunicated. Protestants often call it disfellowship. Catholics call it excommunicated. Now, if that doesn't work, they'll put you in prison. And of course, if that doesn't work, eventually they'll kill you. That's the steps they took. That's the steps every... Just study church history. That's the steps every organization has taken all the way down through history. When somebody in their group doesn't follow the rules of their group, they give you a warning. They've given Jesus a warning. He didn't listen. He disregarded their rules, their traditions. They tell you to stop. So then they excommunicate you. That's not our subject, but I can show you that they excommunicated Jesus and anybody that chose to follow him. And then if that doesn't work, then they're willing to put you in prison and kill you. Just study church history. That's the way it works every time. That's the way it worked in the Protestant Reformation. That's the way it worked in paganism in the early Christian centuries. That's the way it worked with Jesus. By the way, all churches, I say this especially for the benefit of Protestants. Protestants say, oh, well, I'm not a Catholic. Let me tell you, every Protestant church has traditions. I don't have time to go into it. I could show you. Adventists have traditions. Every church has traditions and customs. Jesus violated their traditions. If you violate the traditions of a group, you're considered to have disregarded the authority of the group. That's why he got in trouble. Jesus said, you receive honor from each other. You're not after the honor that comes from God alone. We don't have time to explain that verse. Maybe I can this evening. He closed by saying, don't think that I'm going to accuse you. You know who's accusing you? Moses is accusing you. Just read Moses. He's the one that's accusing you. There are people today, they read about it all the time on the internet, people that claim they are Christian, and yet they say, well, I also believe in the theory of evolution. I say, what? You cannot be both a Christian and believe in the theory of evolution. That's impossible. That's absolutely contradictory beliefs. You can believe what you choose, but you can't believe things that are contradictory if you have a rational mind, except people do. They say they do. Well, he made the most powerful appeal that could be made. He said, if you accept, you're not going to come into judgment. You're going to have eternal life. But it's your choice. You won't come to me that you have life. My dear friend, I say this respectfully of all churches, but no church can save you and give you eternal life. Only Jesus Christ can do that. Are you willing to come to him? Every time I study this story, I say, Lord Jesus, I'm choosing to come to you. I want to be connected with you. Is that who you want to be connected with? Only Jesus Christ can save your soul. But he will save your soul if you'll come to him by faith. Before we sing our closing song, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us make that decision. Father in heaven, we give you thanks that you have made a way that our sins can be forgiven, that our guilt can be taken away, that we can be changed, that we can have a new master, a new father, a new experience, a new heart, and a new spirit. We pray that we might be born again, and that the Holy Spirit might transform us in character so that we will be ready for Jesus to come. Help us to be connected with Him. Help us to come to Him by faith and acknowledge Him as the Lord of our life. And to tell Him from our heart, say, Lord, I want You to be my Lord, my Master, my Savior. I want to follow You, obey You, and do Your will in all things. Help us to make that decision while we have an opportunity. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of His might and the strength of His power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.